Dr. Homebrew is brought to you by Five Star Chemicals, providing safety and cleaning supplies for brewing, distilling, and winemaking at fivestarchemicals.com.
Doctor, look!
Stand aside, nurse. I'm Dr. Homebrew.
Dr. Homebrew. It's Dr. Homebrew, and, you know, this is what we're doing. We got some homebrew, and, you know, we're not doctors.
We luckily have one bottle left of it.
So, yes, we have one homebrew for you guys to, well, one submitted homebrew for you guys to try from Terry, and it's a Pilsner, and it arrived today, and I was like, this guy sent one bottle. I was like, really? Really, Terry? One bottle of beer? And then I realized it was in, like, FedEx packaging, and my address was, like, cut out. It was, like, an X-Acto knife, and so the other two had broken somehow in transit. So we have one bottle, and it's been sitting out for, like, 2 hours and open, and so it's be interesting.
We're not going to talk about Terry's beer. We're just going to talk about packaging.
And then Keith has some beers. Keith has some weird beers.
Yeah.
Or at least one weird beer, right, Keith?
They're both weird beers. I think that discussion is going to be about... I'm going to slow down and try to talk this show, I think. Mm. Which I have a really hard time doing. My brain is always moving faster than my mouth. Or the opposite. I'm not sure which. The point of it is we went to talk about how to categorize your beers for competitions. Like, how to fit something in. Like, hey, I have this... I made a apricot barrel-aged... Porter, brewed with Brett and
kumquats.
Well, you know, apricots and kumquats wouldn't be that. You know,
oh,
dogs'
yeah.
toenails.
I just like to say kumquats.
Whatever, you know, like something like that. Where you're like, where the hell do I enter this beer? And we want to talk a little bit about that and like how to figure out where to enter your beers. I guess because we received one bottle, we could also talk about packaging beers.
Yeah, we could do that. We've done that before, I think.
We did.
Yeah, we did
covered that once.
And, you know, honestly, I've had maybe three or four in all the years of doing the show of three or four bottles break. Yeah. So it's kind of, people are doing a really good job. And I'm thinking about...
The shipping company kind of screws you over.
Yeah. So...
I've been really lucky myself. I sent stuff out to competitions and I bottled my... I'm sorry, I packaged my roommate's beers one time and sent them in two different boxes, my beers and his beers, exact same way, and he got a note saying, all your bottles broke, and mine are all fine, and I'm like, huh.
Yeah.
So it wasn't the way we actually packaged them, it was just like somebody decided to just like crush his like underneath the car tire or something.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Yeah. Sorry, dude.
Exactly.
My brother sent me some beer recently, some New Glarus beer from he lives in Duluth. You know, you can only get it in Wisconsin, so you have to cross the border there. But he'd had problems before with the mailboxes, et cetera, guy getting a little overzealous and like shaking shaking my brother's package.
Yeah, nice.
To see if there was any liquid in there.
Good for him. And, at his age, you never know. There might not be anymore.
After a while.
I usually have a doctor do that, but a mailbox center person is the next best choice, I imagine.
Same
so
thing.
He topped off all the bottles so they wouldn't make any noise, and he like recapped them for me.
Wow.
What did he top? We talked about this last week. What did he top off with the same beer?
He topped it
with one, off with one beer.
And, with the same beer. I filled it all the way up to the crown of the bottle and capped it right there. So one of the bottles broke, and I was like trying to figure out why it broke. I mean, it didn't have all that much cushioning around it. It was kind of separated with a carton, so I think the bottles could probably knock against each other. But you know, all that pressure, if you get a really severe jolt, I mean, that's why there's a headspace in beer, is so you don't, yeah, you know, all that pressure has nowhere to go. Otherwise, it goes into the headspace if you have headspace.
That's why you have headspace.
Otherwise, you might break a bottle.
Yeah. So what beers did you bring, Keith? Back to my fucking question.
Oh, yeah.
Don't dodge my question.
One is a Scottish ale, Scottish export, technically, with sweet potatoes and yams. I'm sorry, sweet potatoes and black mission figs. Sorry.
And sweet potatoes and black mission figs. Okay.
And the other is a Imperial Sweet Stout, aged in a bourbon barrel, with coffee, coconut, and cacao nibs.
Hmm. Oh, okay.
And we're going to categorize this for you.
And technically, it's a blend of things, and that's not that surprising. I like to blend stuff for competitions and all that sort of fun stuff. But Brian and I tried it last week, and we were talking about, like, how do you enter something that has so many ingredients? Where do you put it in the guidelines? We wanted to talk about that and sort of figure that out, and then also say, like, should you be entering this beer at all, and when to say when with too many ingredients. Like, we've in this show, we've had many times where someone said, hey, it's an Imperial Stout, and then they later on tell us, oh, it was actually aged in a bourbon barrel and we added hazelnut to it.
Right.
So it's like, well, why did you do that, and why didn't you tell us that, and where do you want to enter it? And I wanted to taste it and say, like from our perspective, where would you really enter this beer? What flavors are actually, this is one of the big things about entering beers, which flavors can you actually taste? It's not about what's in the beer, it's about what you can actually taste.
Exactly. Well, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to open this crowler of Kolsch, okay? And we're going to drink some of that because I just really want to.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Because, you know, it's the best thing. Here, give me that.
You're tired of looking
thing.
At hoppy.
No, the opener. Yeah,
hoppy beers.
Well, it's, I mean, you know, if we're going to drink all these weird fucking beers that Keith was trying to force us to drink, I'm going to have a Kolsch. This is actually from Warren's place of employment, Loma.
Don Loma, nice.
Company. And, yeah, a little Kolsch. Pop a little Kolsch there. And, you know.
I've won best of show with Kolsch, maybe.
Here, do me a favor,
times.
Brian. Help me out with that bullshit.
Okay. Yeah, I'll help you out here, buddy.
It is really full.
Thank you.
And they just started crowlering.
And so where's it from, JP?
Los
Loma
Gatos.
In Los Gatos. This is where Warren brews. You know, Loma is the California Brewery of the Year, according to the California State Fair people.
Hmm.
So, anyway, we're going to do this. We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to come back, and we're going to either talk to Terry about his pills, or we're going to talk to Brian about whatever Brian is going to talk to us about.
Oh, I want to talk.
And then we're going to drink. I also have a can of Solidarity from Eagle Rock, which is my favorite beer in the entire universe. So that is released, and we're going to drink some of that, too. So anyway, it's you know, a lot of beer today, folks, so, you know, enjoy it.
Hello, fellow BNers. This is Sully from the 21st Amendment Brewery located in San Francisco, just two blocks from Giants Park. Before Nico and I opened the 21A and before I was a professional brewer, I homebrewed on my small four-burner apartment stove in a back house in Santa Monica, California, making my extract brews before graduating to the daunting idea of all-grain brewing. Homebrew books and information was hard to come by back then. The internet hadn't been invented yet, along with other things we take for granted today, like electricity and potable water. One thing I wish I had back then when I was learning was a radio show that could teach me the ins and outs of brewing and answer questions that I had about homebrewing, a resource for making great craft beer. The 21st Amendment Brewery is excited to be a proud sponsor of Dr. Homebrew, a great show that teaches you what you need to know about making incredible beer. Good stuff. Listen up. You might learn something. I certainly did. And thanks for your support. Tasty Crack Games.
Since the first time the Brewing Network microphones turned on, More Beer was behind it. More Beer sponsors the programming on the BN because, like you, they love brewing. And like the Brewing Network, they love sharing their knowledge. Morebeer.com isn't just a website to place your next equipment or ingredient order. Morebeer.com also gives you access to free beer information that will make you a better brewer. Go to morebeer.com and click into the Learning Center. You'll find podcasts, technical facts, video tutorials, and more, including access to The Buzz, More Beer's social network of more than 5,000 members. And some of them might even be crazier about beer than you are. Get over to morebeer.com today and take advantage of The Buzz, the forum, the Learning Center, and make sure you're signed up to receive the newest More Beer catalog. More Beer, bringing you absolutely everything for beer making.
Now, back to the examination.
All right, welcome back, Dr. Homebrew, everybody. I think Brian's lost his damn mind, but
Los Gatos isn't near Gilroy. There's no way. Gilroy's like Central Valley shit, bro.
It's Garlic Town, right?
It's not Central Valley.
Isn't it? I'm still like an idiot. I've been here like 3 years, and I'm always like, where is Gilroy's, this place?
Gilroy's like parallel with Santa Cruz. It's 30, well, I guess you're right. It's 36 minutes away. Okay.
6 minutes. All right. From LG.
Well, you found your damn mind then.
Well, you have to go through Morgan Hill. So, like, you know, there's San Jose. It just keeps stretching down. You go to Los Gatos, and then you know, you're down into Morgan Hill, and then you're into Gilroy. I just think of it as one big continuous stretch of,
I guess I never really,
you know, stuff. And then just the stuff starts smelling more like garlic the further down you go.
Yeah, that's true. All right, we're going to get Terry on the line
here. It's like an esophagus.
But before we do that, I do want to thank Five Star, of course. I forgot about that. Our fine title sponsor, Five Star Chemicals. Go to fivestarchemicals.com. Learn about everything you need to do to start making your beer better if you're not using Five Star, that is, of course. And if you're already using them, you know how well all that stuff works, PBW and the Star Sand and Sandy Clean and all that kind of stuff. So check them out, fivestarchemicals.com. Terry, are you here, bud?
Yeah, I'm right here, Jake.
Hey, how you doing, man?
Good, man. How are you doing tonight?
Perfect. We're just drinking some Kolsch now. You know, a lot of light lager-esque beers, and so, you know, it's a good night for me.
It's a nice crisp Kolsch we got.
None of them are IPAs, and I can't even begin to comment on how good everything's going. We're pouring your
excellent
beer now. Yeah, I apologize, man. I don't know what happened. Two bottles broke. So that sucks.
Sorry about that. That's the first time that's happened. Usually it's not an issue.
Yeah, we don't. I was saying that during the beginning of the show. Like, it's rarely happened to me, if ever. You know, in the last, what, 3 or 4 years I've been doing this show, just maybe a handful of times.
Glad I could be one of the first.
Yeah,
well, it is football season. Sometimes those FedEx and UPS guys like to play.
Did you see the
drop kick the box in the back of there? You know?
Tony Romo kicked the ball like this. Watch me.
Oh, beer came out. Yay.
Yeah. All right.
You guys don't watch a lot of football, do you?
No.
Tony Romo?
I don't know, man.
He's actually
an announcer.
Color
now.
Commentary, yeah, commentator no. now.
Tony Romo?
Yeah, I don't know.
Isn't that
never kicked
place?
The ball either, although he may have kicked his own, I don't know, something. You know, he's always hurting himself all the time, so.
I appreciate that you explained my joke.
Yeah, that's good. No worries.
Thank you, Keith.
That's what I'm here for.
Thank you, Keith. All right,
sports.
Terry, well, let's talk about you for a second. How long have you been homebrewing, my friend?
So I've been brewing about 7-8 years now, something like that. Started with a friend of mine and quickly realized that I was a lot more into it than he was. Split off and got all my own gear. And I've been all grain for about 5 years now.
Wow, that sounds like a lot of relationships I was in. Like, I was more into it than she was, so I just split off on my own.
Yeah. Took your equipment with you?
Yeah, we had a kid together, and she wasn't as much into that, and I just kept him.
Do you guys, like, still, I mean, I know you didn't, like, fight or whatever, but does he,
talk.
Like, come over and brew and all that kind of stuff, or does he look at you?
He actually moved back to the Midwest where he's from and got his degree from Siebel And is currently just kind of trying to get his stuff together to open a brewery back in Des Moines.
Oh, there you go.
But other than that, no, we still get together and everything.
Nice.
Cool. Can.
Yeah, Seattle's got a good brewery. Yeah.
The Midwest is where you got to go to open a brewery, man. There's you don't do it on the West
anymore.
Coast. Don't do it on the East Coast.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's the
yeah, here, here in Denver, the market's just totally saturated.
Yeah, absolutely. It's it's everywhere, man. And, you know, they're saying now, like, oh, well, you know, back before Prohibition, every neighborhood had a bar. Yeah, but they were making like a dollar a day. I mean, you know what I mean? It wasn't that much money, but now you got some sections of town where you have three breweries. Well, exactly. Who's going to go? How long can that possibly last? You know what I mean? Anyway.
Well, they're still growing, so we'll see.
Even in the Midwest, too, man. Duluth has a ton of breweries.
It's everywhere. Everywhere you go, they're like, oh, we have a lot of breweries here now. And it's like, everybody has a lot of breweries now. Everywhere you go.
Yeah.
My only big concern, it is great. My only big concern is that there's some people who are in it for the money or they're not really ready for prime time and they just sort of roll out their stuff. I'm like, hey, we're going to make beer. We're going to make money out of this. And I don't know. Like, that's my big concern about all of it. Like, make sure you have your quality down before you...
Exactly.
You know, for your customers. Like, I mean, if you taste something and it's not good, then get rid of it. And do you know what not good tastes like? You know, and that's what Brian and I are here for. Like, you know, like, hey, we can taste beers for people and, you know, know where, like, things are not, like, up to par. And, like, you know, like, I don't know.
But, it's amusing, too, when you have someone that's just a business person and they, like, I'm just going to start a brewery. Well, have you ever brewed? No. But, you know, it's like, well, I mean, it takes, you know, you kind of got to have a good business person and a good brewer together to kind of make it fly.
Someone homebrew sometimes, you get, like, the whole, like, hey, my friends all like it. They all say I should open a brewery. Well, like, well, yeah, because you're giving them free beer all the time and they're going to tell you that it's really great. So.
Speaking of free beer, let's talk about Terry's.
All right, Terry. Tell us about this beer, man. What's going on here?
Okay, so this was, Jay, I don't know if you were associated with it, but this was the Can You Brew It episode of Ska Mexican Lager.
Yeah, I actually brewed this. I actually brewed this beer. That was the one
so
I brewed
was,
it for
I
the
mean,
show.
The show was from a while ago, but I took the recipe straight off of what you guys recommended, basically.
Okay.
Used a different yeast.
Okay, I thought it was a German Pils. I thought you had emailed me.
That beer was like 8 months ago. That thing is long gone.
Ah, okay. That's my fault. Okay. Shit.
Yeah, dude. That was a long time ago.
I think I screwed Brian and Keith over then. That was the heading of the email, so that's all I kept seeing. Is just
so tell us
pills.
About the beer that you're cloning. Educate us here.
Basically, the Ska beer, it's a light Mexican lager, about just under, just right about 5%. 15 IBUs, something like that. Touch of Munich, touch of Victory. And it's actually got like a pound of corn sugar in it, according to JP, at least. Just
it's the email that I got from the guys. I remember. I think I still have that email, too, actually.
It's fine. I mean, it's a fantastic beer if you guys have never tried it. I mean, Scott makes a lot of really good stuff.
I don't have any more.
Can you get us some of that beer, JP?
I think you can find Mexican lager out here, actually, a little bit.
What would we judge it as?
Well, probably international pale lager, I think technically would be the category for Mexican lager.
Yeah,
is that right?
That's my guess as well, yeah.
Like a 2A or something like that?
Like, have you had El Sully from 2A yet?
Yeah,
it's that same concept.
Same kind of, yeah. So I think this beer came out a little bit maltier than I was expecting. I mean, it uses two row instead of like a Pilsner malt.
Mm-hmm.
So two row and then a touch of Munich and Victory, I think, to help round it out. So it does seem a little bit maltier than a standard kind of Mexican lager to me.
Well, and you're in the Ska territory. You've probably had this beer, I imagine?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah.
What do you think of the recipe compared to yours?
I think theirs, you know, I just had some of theirs at the GABF a few weeks ago, and theirs seems a little drier and crisper than mine does. And okay. I did use a different yeast. I used, like, WLP 833. On it from
German,
the previous batch.
Was that a German lager or something?
Yeah, it's like the South German or German Bock lager is what it is.
Why did you throw an audible on the yeast there?
That's what I had. I had a slurry of it that I got from a local brewery
Oh, okay.
That makes excellent German beers, and so I just threw it on there and see what it would do. Didn't feel like paying more for the Mexican lager yeast.
No, okay. I mean that's an awesome lager yeast. It's like actually my favorite. The Bock is across the board my favorite, but in a style like this, it is probably a little bit of a mismatch, I would say. But that's okay. But no. I mean, A33 is like my favorite yeast strain in the world. If I would open a brewery and brew lagers only, I would use that. And then it's kind of like, which styles can you do? Which one you can't do? But I think it's an awesome. It's a low sulfur, low diacetyl yeast strain, pretty temperature tolerant across the board. But it's a lot of fun. It's the Eyinger strain.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Bock is kind of a misnomer in some ways. You know, it's like, well, they call it that. But yeah, it's like. I'm not sure even Eyinger's really. I guess yeah. Okay, never mind. They are known for their Doppelbock, but yeah.
You asked a question and you answered it before
answered
you could ask
my own
it.
Brain. Like I said before, yes.
So okay, guys. Well, up front, I apologize. This is totally my fault. So you're going to have to basically do this on the fly and talk about this beer and ask questions. So, Keith, why don't you start, because Brian is still researching.
I've done no research on this, and got to be honest here, I've had a few beers, so this is going to be really entertaining.
yeah, because normally we do all these before the show.
Yeah, and normally we have
them. We're fresh, right.
This is totally off the cuff, and I'm also was judging as a German Pils, so I'll try to change it a little bit, but I think a lot of these comments will still be sort
of... you did have the movement of the German and Austrian brewers to Mexico, so, I mean, they influenced that style.
Yeah, absolutely. This one's going to be, well...
But it's different.
Yeah.
So I got a low malt, a little bit of graininess, medium, low hop aroma. I got this strong white wine aroma, kind of like a Pinot Gris. Tropical fruit, a little bit of sulfur, some melon, sweetness. I thought hops that were subdued, which would make a lot of sense, being that it's a Mexican lager, not a German Pilsner style.
Definitely.
I thought the malt sweetness came out more as it warmed. Medium gold with a wispy, long-lasting head. Color's a tad darker, I thought, than a German Pils should be. Once again, not German Pils. Brilliantly clear. Was really kind of wavering. This is kind of more of a judge comment. Wavering between a 2 and a 3. Appearance doesn't really mean that much. I really hate when people put 2.5 down. So I gave it a 2. Flavor, I got that fruitiness again. That melon. Even maybe more now at this point, like apple, pear, medium low bitterness. The balance leans toward the hop. The balance is kind of even, maybe a little bit toward the hops, but thought for the style it was kind of more medium than it should be. But once again, now that this is a trying to recalibrate myself, being that it's a international pale, I would say maybe it's a little hoppy. kind of hard to do that.
Swung the other way.
Yeah, so it's getting that strong melon. Malt is pretty one-dimensional, sweet. I thought esters were a little high. I was assuming I was assuming it was the esters that were producing that apple melon sort of character and not any sort of hop choice. Otherwise, very clean. No diacetyl, no acetaldehyde. Medium low body, medium high carbonation, very low warming, light astringency from bittering. All probably appropriate for this style as well. So I thought I said the balance was nearly right, could use a little more bitterness. I think for this, maybe dial back the bitterness a little bit. Let's see. Let me think about this. For the most part,
that's going to make it sweeter, though.
Yeah. For the most part, I really, the thing that hit me was just that sort of tropical. Well, not necessarily tropical, but a lot of the esters. I thought there was a lot of esters in this. Interested in hearing about the fermentation temps, yeast health, etc. I said I'd up the hops. With doing this style, I would not up the hops for this, but really look into your yeast fermentation. And now, like JP was asking about the yeast strain. I think for a Mexican lager sort of style, international pale, you want to make sure something that ferments really, really dry. And even though 833 can get pretty low in terms of final gravity, you still have that perception of sweetness a lot of times that comes through. But I really, you know, I'll let Brian give feedback first, but I'm interested in hearing what your fermentation schedule was like and all that sort of fun stuff.
Okay, sure.
My score was a 29, but that was for a German Pilsner. Let me give it one taste right here and try to think about how that would recalculate as a international pale lager.
Okay.
I think it's a 29.
Okay. Oh. Fair enough. All right, Brian.
I'm more creative than that.
That was so creative.
Let's
the
go.
Same. That was actually
let's prove
more
it.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah.
Your perception of creativeness is so square, dude.
Try to convince me. So in the aroma, I got a bright, bready, and honey-like malt character up front. An edge of kind of some floral, spicy hops in there. I didn't get any obvious esters. I can see a little bit of apple pear, but it's not huge to me in the nose. No DMS or diacetyl. Seems fairly cleanly lagered. The appearance, I gave it a 3, unlike Keith. I found a bright golden-colored beer with a white head of fine bubbles with good retention. I liked that, and it fit the... Well, it you know, for a pils, it might be... Well, I think it's a good color.
Straw to light gold, that looks a little bit...
It's
deep gold, medium deep gold to me. That's even, you know, the cream ale we talked about could be a little bit darker
gold,
than a pils. And
ish. Yeah, it's not yellow, so it's into gold. Okay, fine. 2.5, Keith. flavor wise, there's a medium pleasant bready malt in there. The bitterness is low and out of the way. Medium low hop flavor. Again, just a little bit of floral, spicy herbal balancing against the malt, but definitely the malt wins out. It's balanced through the malt, and there's a little bit of sweetness to it as well. What I was seeing when it, you know, when I was thinking German pils is that it lacks the crispness that is typical of that style.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the minerals seemed quite low. It's maybe a little softer finish for a pils. But if you were going to Mexican lager, a nice soft finish is more appropriate. So I would probably go up on the score there. Again, no DMS or diacetyl. Mouthfeel wise, medium light bodied, no astringency. It's pretty smooth, a bit of creamy smoothness. I thought I got a hint of a little bit of heat in the back of the throat there. I don't know if the yeast kicked out something a little bit of higher alcohol in there. It doesn't seem like it's a strong beer, but there's a light little kind of maybe solventy warmth going on there.
It's supposed to be like 5%, I think, right?
Yeah,
now,
you shouldn't detect any real alcohol, but I'm getting something in there that's distracting me there a little bit. So I knocked the mouthfeel score down a little bit for whichever style it is.
It is hard because it's room temp now at this
medium
point.
Medium low carbonation. Yeah. Yeah, we blame JP for all of that.
This is one that I'll actually carry.
Own it. Yeah.
Wow. That's a first.
So as a international pale lager, it's a pleasant drinking beer. It's I didn't get a lot of big fruitiness in it. It's a pleasant drinking beer. It has a lot of the qualities that you'd want in an international pale lager or a Mexican lager, L-O-G-G-E-R, I guess it is.
Yep.
That heat is a little distracting, and it's a little sweeter in the finish than I would like. It should dry off and be even a little smoother and more refreshing and bump up the carbonation a little bit. It's kind of just medium-low. It should be kind of medium to medium-high, I think.
I don't know. I mean, yeah. Okay.
Moderately high to highly carbonated.
Your own questions again?
Yeah.
Okay.
Bumping up the carbonation is just going to drive more of the flavors that are there and are just, it'll dry off your tongue a little faster and give a little carbonic bite that you get in some of these beers. It had a lot going on for it. Just that heat is a little distracting. It doesn't quite pop. I mean, I was looking for that crispness of the German pils. Now I'm looking for a smooth kind of international pale lager.
Less malt character.
It's actually maybe a little more characterful than an international pale lager should be. It's a very malt forward beer to me. So, you might want to back off some of the, we'll talk about your recipe, but some of the malts that are giving it that color too, you'd lighten up the color if you dropped any of the darker malts that are in there a little bit and kind of clean that up a little bit. So, yeah.
I'd have to say, it is a clone of Ska, but
yeah.
a victory in a traditional Mexican lager seems like a...
Yeah, it is kind of an out-of-style beer.
Yeah,
I wouldn't even call it like an old-school beer. It's one of the first craft styles of this that I had had, and it's definitely not like a Modelo clone or something like that. It is its own kind of animal. So,
and that's the thing about getting into categorization too, because there's actually a category now for clone beers. You can have a clone beer, but how many people in that competition? I mean, if it's in the area where that brewery is, they might know it, but otherwise, if you enter it in some competition somewhere else, they have no idea.
Yeah, that doesn't seem fair. That's going to cause...
I enter clones of my own beer clones. So I brew a beer, and then I say, hey, this is a clone of this beer I just made before.
It's a clone of batch number 43.
What did you give it, Brian?
I gave it a 33 as a German pils. I want to give it a 35 as an international pale lager.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty nice. Just a couple of little detractors in there and a little balance thing, but just judging it straight to the style. Now, as the Ska Mexican lager clone, I couldn't tell you. I've never tried it.
I mean, just from palate memory, right? Like, it's, and you can tell me if I'm wrong, Terry, but it is kind of a grainier beer. It has some chewy mouthfeel to it, but it should finish just a little drier. Yeah. And was it hoppy too? I can't really remember. It's been a while.
It's, the beer is listed at like 16 IBUs, so it doesn't have, it's got a little bit in there, but I wouldn't call it hoppy by any means. But for a Mexican lager, it is a little bit hoppy, I would say, definitely. Yeah.
Okay.
Do you all think I'm crazy with the white wine reference? I mean, I know Brian does from his feedback, but...
Crazy? No. I think I didn't get a whole lot
of that. I get some of that, too.
Okay.
I definitely like some of the fruitiness and wininess. That's something that I get sometimes in my lagers that I'm really working on trying to eliminate just to clean it up a lot more, but I definitely get some of that.
That's cool, Terry. You have a better palate than both Brian and JP, then, obviously.
It's probably... It's probably.
I doubt that.
What about the? What
Terry's
about the
a
heat?
Master. You didn't,
did anyone else get the little heat in the back of the throat?
I did not.
Okay,
I did not.
I didn't get that either, Brian.
But this is the cool part about judging. I just want to put a microscope over this section real quickly. Is you can have people who are qualified and who judge beer and do the, and you have things that the other one doesn't pick up.
Yeah, yeah. And last show we did, we were like. So you didn't even need us to read both of our score sheets because we were just so closely aligned that it was like, wow, we were just there. It was like, yeah, we knew exactly what we're talking about. We're like, this is it. This is what we're talking. This is the same exact sort of feedback. And this one, we're kind of just divergent. Like just totally
Keith probably ate a bunch of spicy food before he came,
I always eat spicy. I did. I always eat spicy food. I have no problem with that.
It messes me up. I avoid spicy food for a week before the show usually if I can.
Wow. Oh. That's dedication.
That's stupid.
And I love spicy food.
Terry, do you have any questions about this?
Well, I guess kind of all you guys mentioned the sweetness, and I agree that it is a little bit sweet. This beer actually finished at 10.07, so it dried out pretty considerably, which I was really surprised that it came off a little sweet. I think it uses quite a bit of saaz in there, and my saaz were 2 years old. They'd been sitting in it. And a pack in my freezer, so I don't know if the old hops may have contributed to that sweetness.
Yeah,
are you
considering
multiple,
how dry it is?
Multiple hydrometers to take your final gravity. I don't know. I always try to do that sort of thing. Like when I see numbers that are kind of weird, and that's one thing I would check out just to make sure those numbers are actually right.
That's interesting. I use like a finishing gravity hydrometer that's got the bigger marks on it.
Yeah, I've had some of those that worked well. And I had one that was just kind of like totally off, and I always double check that.
I check mine against my refractometer to make sure that those are kind of in line. But yeah, it doesn't taste like 1007.
But as you mentioned, you used 833, which gives a perception of more sweetness too. That yeast just doesn't matter what the final gravity is; it always makes it seem like there's more sweetness there too. And
so, yeah.
Interesting.
Well, maybe try it again with the recommended. What was the recommended strain?
Actual yeast. The recommended yeast was like the White Labs Mexican Lager yeast. I'm pretty sure.
All right.
Well, Go ahead. Sorry.
When you mentioned the mineral level, this was like super soft water. I mean, it was like 10 ppm of everything. So I don't know if a little bit more gypsum in there might help kind of accentuate or get rid of some of that sweetness effect as well.
Yeah, that was another thing I was going to say, is if you have a lot of like chlorides in your water, it can accent the sweetness. There's a lot of other things that can give the impression of sweetness, sodium. Yeah. Sulfates will give it a little sharper minerally character to play off the hops a little bit. So you might get away with not even increasing the hops, or just use a little fresher hop with it and try to get the IBUs that you want.
And this is kind of
okay. And I use distilled water and build it from there. But
don't go crazy. Yeah, just go to 50 calcium and a little bit of sulfate.
Okay. I agree with Brian totally there. I really don't like the whole like, hey, I'm gonna put it up to 300 parts per million of like sulfate just keep it low. And sorry, I was doing my.
He was staring at me.
Kissinger.
I don't know what was going on there.
I think really the goal there is to keep the parts per million, like for calcium, up around 50. But even for lagers, I don't think you need to necessarily do that. For this yeast strain, I think you can keep it lower. But I think for this beer, I think you probably hit a little bit harder.
Cool. In the 40s or something,
Yeah.
Anything else, Terry?
Well, I think that pretty much does it. Just looking for some more feedback and, if there's anything else I could do to make it, a little bit crisper. I'm all ears.
Playing with the water is going to help you with that for sure.
Yeah, play with the water, change the yeast up, and I think try it again and see what those things do. And then, because you don't want to make too many changes, because then you're never going to know what actually is.
You don't know what did it.
Yeah.
Right.
Go subtle. Yeah.
Sure.
But cool beer. Interesting. I'll have to find that the real beer somewhere.
It's tasty. You'd like it.
Cool.
All right, man.
Cheers, guys.
Thanks, Terry.
Thank you, Terry.
Yep.
All right. Later.
Bye.
No. All right.
All right. Let's pretend I never screwed up. Let's pretend I didn't screw up. We're going to be right back, and we're going to come back. And what are we talking about? Categorizing beers?
Yes.
And how to pick what category we go into. We're going to taste Keith's beer. And
it's the segment we like to call Stop Bitching About Entering Your Beer. Just categorize in the right place. And
or don't enter it at
call
all.
Call out the,
it's the longest
major characteristics,
ever.
Comma, or don't enter it at all, period.
What's the acronym
semicolon.
For that? At the break, we're going to work on the acronym for that. We'll be right back.
Get the category right.
Do you know the three most important rules in brewing? Sanitation, sanitation, and sanitation. And no one does it better than Five Star Chemicals. Five Star knows sanitation. You can only sanitize clean equipment. And Five Star knows how to clean, too. For craft brewers and home brewers, Five Star has what you need to keep your fermenters, serving tanks, kegs, and draft lines sparkling and free of any beer-spoiling bacteria. PBW, caustic, acid cleaners, Starsan, SantaClean, lubricants and defoamers, pH stabilizers, and more. Five Star Chemicals has cleaning supplies, safety supplies, heat exchangers, pumps, hoses, and valves. And Five Star is proud to offer eco-friendly products that exceed customer expectations. If you have a cleaning problem, you need the Five Star solution. Visit fivestarchemicals.com or call 800-782-7019. 800-782-7019 and get the Five-star treatment today.
Are you a member of the White Labs Customer Club? If not, you should be. It's the easiest way to earn free stuff for turning in your old homebrew labels from either vials or pure pitch. All you have to do is save your labels and redeem them for things like free yeast, an exclusive White Labs t-shirt or sweatshirt, and even the opportunity to brew with the yeast man himself, Chris White. Signing up is easy. Just go to whitelabs.com/customerclub, fill out the registration form, and then mail in your labels. They will return the favor by sending you awesome White Labs swag. Go sign up today at whitelabs.com/customerclub. White Labs, pure yeast and fermentation since 1995.
I'm sorry to tell you this, but we're going to have to pour you out.
Back to Dr. Homebrew.
All right, thanks for hanging out, everybody. Before we get on to anything better, I want to tell you guys about the Brew Guru app. It's from the AHA, you know, the American Homebrew Association, and it tells you where all the good deals are for beer and homebrewing ingredients as well. As a matter of fact, a lot of homebrew shops give a discount for being an AHA member. And with the Brew Guru app, you just link your AHA membership number into the app, and then the app will do its work and will show you where to go to the homebrew shops to get these deals, to where to go to brew pubs, to where to go to breweries to get, like, money off of wings and shit like that. So check it out. It's the Brew Guru app. It's free. It's for all the iPhones and all the Androids, which is, you know, the superior platform, let's be completely honest. And it's free. Did I mention that? So check it out. Brew Guru app. It's from the AHA. They love you and we love you. And the Brew Guru will treat you better than any of us can. All right, Brian, what are we going to talk about? I know we have some beers from Keith to drink, and so I think Keith
out,
should pour
it out, whatever you want to do. I noticed the Brew Guru was featured on the latest edition of Zymergy on the outside cover.
Oh, yeah, I saw that, too.
Well, there
yeah.
you go.
Brew Guru 2.0.
Well, there you are.
So everybody should know about it. Everybody should listen to the show, of course, but even if they don't.
That's true.
Maybe we should get on the cover of Zymergy for the next... A picture of the three of us could make everybody.
let's try to make that happen. Pour your beers here, homie. Let's go.
Yeah.
Let me drink these. What is it? A prune and tomato juice clone, or what are you talking about?
No, that's the FDR thing they're doing.
No. Oh.
So yeah. No, actually, my whole topic, that long topic, was all of that was my whole talk.
Oh, we're done.
Yeah.
Oh, all
just
right. Stop bitching. All right, everybody. Thank you for joining.
And just enter your beer where it belongs.
Okay.
But yeah, there's ways you can do that. No, I mean, I was thinking about ideas with and emailing JP, thinking, you know, we could do a segment. You know, a lot of people need advice for categorizing their beers to when they're, you know, you want to send it in. And a lot of times people come up to me with a beer and say, you know, where should I enter this? It's got this and this and this in it. And it's like, well, you know, you taste it and decide what's coming through. I mean, but first, you know, there's a few pet peeves for me as a judge. You know, one is just super weird beers that should never be made. You know, just too many weird things going on in the beer, and you know, you don't get the balance. Not all the things are going to come through, and there could be some really light flavors mixed in with heavier flavors, and all you're getting are the heavier flavors, and it's like, why'd you do that? So. You know, another pet peeve would be entrants declaring things that are just completely buried or not there at all, even, you know, in the beer. So you get a beer like with, you know, chili pepper. There's cayenne pepper in this beer. Like, you drink it, there's no heat, there's no chili flavor, nothing. And it's like,
right.
Okay, they went way too subtle on, and they put it in a, you know, a barley wine that's just buried or something. You know what I mean? So think about the style you're pairing the ingredient with, too.
Can I throw one in there, Brian, on that? Like,
yeah.
The opposite of thinking
yeah.
that you don't taste something. I mean, it's on your list. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Please continue.
Yes. Entrance not declaring things that are obviously there. It's like,
there
this
go.
Beer is full of chocolate. It has to be dry nibbed, and they just forgot to declare it or whatever, you know. And then, you know, just then the subtleties beyond that, deciding between, you know, where to put it, spice or vegetable versus a fruit beer versus a barrel versus a catch-all specialty beer category, you know. Or if all of that stuff is really subtle, just entering it as a base style, you know, you got to figure out what to do with it. So it's like, oh, I made this a pumpkin beer, but it doesn't taste like pumpkin because I didn't put any spices in it. So this is a nice dry IPA or something and whatever. I don't know. And then, yeah, just properly declaring the base style, making sure you don't omit any other important information, you know, for specialty beers and stuff like that. So just basically the overarching thing is how to get a judge to understand your beer for what it is, help them know what you're going for and just to
okay.
better be able to judge it.
Well, yeah, don't do what I did and say it's a German Pils when it's really a Mexican lager. Don't do that because it's going to feel bad.
And in so doing, you can also economize on your description of the beer, make it more concise. So it's like, okay, this is with this and that. And then, okay, that makes sense to me.
Should you put it in the order of, like...
intensity?
Yeah. Thank you. Order of intensity. So if it's a Saison that's been barrel-aged in a whiskey barrel, would you say it's a Saison barrel-aged whiskey barrel? Right.
Yeah.
Or would you say bourbon barrel-aged Saison? With spices.
I think one of the fun things you can do is you actually are allowed to put stuff in the description. And usually judges do see those in a good competition. They'll actually list the description. So you can say, like, you can actually say a medium intensity. Like, you don't want to put in those words necessarily with light rosemary character. Like, you know, so they know not to think about, like, oh, it's going to be overpowered with rosemary. I'm just looking for a little rosemary, a hint of rosemary. So you can actually do things like that. And one of the problems with that, though, is a lot of times in entries, you're only given so many characters to put stuff in. And if you put special characters, that's more of a dev sort of joke bullshit. Like, special characters, like, you know, they're going to take up more spaces. No. But anyway, you know, like, you only have so much space. And a lot of times they actually cut it off. So you're given a sheet and they cut things off. And as a judge, what you should do is, like, hey, can I see the full description, because the person running the comp will have that. So you should always ask for that if you're judging. But I think you use the full amount of space if possible and describe it as the best you can. You don't want to say things like, you can't taste the rosemary, but it's there. You don't want to say that.
Right.
But, you know, like a light rosemary character. Like,
but you want to give the judge at least a heads up onto how deep they should be looking for a flavor. Or how. Okay. All right.
But, I mean, if they can't taste it, then don't list it.
Don't, like, declare it.
Yeah. This is one of the reasons to join a homebrew club or join up with other people who judge and taste beers, because they can give you a lot of feedback here. So, you know, in my past, people have always been like, hey, this is a foreign stout. I'm like, yeah, that tastes like a robust porter. And they enter it and they win, you know. And you're like, yeah, that's cool. Like, you know, you nailed it with that. But, like, you know, it doesn't matter what you're brewing. It matters what it tastes like. And that's the really important thing to think about, like, it doesn't matter if it was the award-winning recipe six times and you're like, oh, I'm going to brew it myself. And then you bring it to a club and everyone's like, oh, that's great, but it tastes more like a porter than a stout. Don't be stubborn and enter it as a stout. Like, enter it as a porter.
And
like,
that's been my problem with my oatmeal stout that I brought on a few times. I want it to be an oatmeal stout, and it's just not. Mm-hmm. And actually, there's a category. I've just realized this. There's a category called oatmeal porter. And I think that beer would go well in that category, because that's essentially what it is. It's not roasty enough to be a stout.
Yeah.
But that's to your point, Keith. Like, I'm trying to crowbar it in there and make it fit and make the judges go, no, they're gonna notice the great brewing capabilities of Jason. And it's never going to be that.
I think oatmeal is a really weird thing, because I'm not sure I've ever actually tasted, like, oatmeal. Like, hey, it's silky and it's... and it tastes like oatmeal. Like,
no.
This doesn't happen. Like, even when I've had commercial oatmeal stouts, it's not necessarily like that. It's like, maybe some perception of it, but
yeah,
I don't know.
It's more, like, of a mouthfeel thing than anything else. Like,
mouthfeel is my least. That's probably one of my worst abilities to taste. You know, mouthfeel. I always struggle with body. And
that's the creaminess and the, like, little oiliness that you get with it. That just it works. But yeah. Yeah, like you're saying, just declare what is there, what stands out, and, you know, in balance with the beer style, because you want to get the beer style alongside the special ingredient. If there's stuff that just get buried by it, like you made a Saison that has plenty of white pepper phenols in it, and then you put white pepper in it. Like, it's a little bit, but if you don't actually taste the white pepper separately from the style, and B, why would you mix that, you know, as you do something different with it? Put a fruit in it instead or something, you know. But
you can play up those things. It's like
you can.
I don't know, like, to use an analogy of, like, a TV show where you're given, like, whatever, like, Chopped or some bullshit like that. You're given an ingredient, and then you can, like, kind of bump up the ingredient. So, like, you know, I don't know, if you're making a wit, and then by accident you put too much orange peel, or you put something in, like, a lot of, like, blood orange or something, you can say, like, it's a wit with extra, like, blood orange, and enter it in a separate category and not actually as a wit. I don't know. There's, like, something about that where it's, like, you can take an ingredient and then, like, amplify it. And it's kind of a cool thing. Yeah, no. It's kind of a neat thing like that. But the first beer I brought to give you guys to jump onto that was, it's a Scottish ale. So it's a Scottish export.
Okay.
Sort of. It's made, you know, traditionally as a Scottish export, but it has, in the mash, it has sweet potatoes. And I think for a 10-gallon batch, it's like six and a half pounds of sweet potatoes in the mash. Hmm. And then fermented pretty cold, like 58, 59, and then added Black Mission figs, dried Black Mission figs, in basically near the end of fermentation. I wanted to drop off some of the yeast so I could use it for a wee heavy, and then left some of the yeast behind and made sure it would actually eat the Black Mission figs, which are pretty much straight sugar, but took the dried figs, pureed them with some vodka, dumped them in. But I think the one thing I'm kind of a little bit weary about is that I let it ferment again at like 70 degrees when those black Mission figs got in. Mm-hmm. So there's some fruitiness there, and I'm not sure how much is from the potato,
right,
the figs, or the fact that last burst of fermentation for the figs happened at a high temperature.
It was warmer, yeah.
But I don't know. I think it's kind of a neat beer. The interesting thing about it is, like, where would you enter it? Like, and it's not that far off from a Scottish ale. It's like, well, it's kind of a little bit of a fruity Scottish ale. I wouldn't want to enter it as a Scottish ale, but, like, is there enough differentiation or something you can actually taste that would be like, hey, this is a fruit beer, or, you know, or this is a spiced herb vegetable. So this is an interesting beer because it has vegetables and it has fruit in it. But where the heck does it land, you know?
Yeah, I don't think so. And I think, you know, maybe with like the oatmeal stouts and with something like a sweet potato, maybe you would have to toast them a little bit and caramelize those sugars.
Oh, you did. Okay, for like 3 hours they're in the oven, like I think maybe 350, something like that, and caramelize them. And even then, I'm not sure how much flavor you really get from them.
Yeah, I feel like the sweet potato is really subtle. But yeah, I do get a little bit of fig-like character. So this one, I would just enter it as
I mean, a little bit of fig, but yeah, maybe not. I don't know. I would think it's more of the... If you didn't tell me it was fig, I would think it's a kind of an aged dark malt flavor.
Yeah.
I mean, I know you were... When you first... I first gave you this, you're like, oh, God, I don't want to drink this, but it is... It's okay. It's just
pretty good.
It's just a beer. Yeah,
it's like you said, it's not that bad. And then when you said vodka...
It's not that bad.
It's not that bad. Now I'm tasting vodka. Like a thinner, like, I don't know, hot.
There's very, very, very little vodka.
Like I know, but that's my, that's
it,
like.
It went to his head.
Right?
Yeah.
It's a pretty young, fresh beer, and it's, it was about 1068 OG, so it was a pretty big beer to start with, and then, you know.
It's going to smooth out and change as it ages, yeah.
It's not going to age. It's going to be consumed tomorrow, probably. Oh. I hope so.
Okay.
There's a, at the Ferry Building in San Francisco, we're doing a pairing with food with this beer, so.
Or it'll all be dumped in front of you.
It's going to be a cheesecake with figs, I think caramelized onions, and I think there's one other ingredient, but I was thinking about taking part of it and blending it with some sour. I tried that today. Maybe spicing some of it, and then also maybe adding some maple syrup to part of it.
Spicing it would be good. Don't do the maple syrup because I don't want it. But I think spicing
it
would be good.
I tried the maple syrup the other night. Like man, it's way too sweet.
Cinnamon, nutmeg kind of thing.
Yeah, I'm thinking Saigon.
Star anise or something.
Saigon cinnamon, a little bit of vanilla, and then maybe some plum extract.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know.
It's decent, but yeah, I don't think I would be able to pick out those two flavors in there.
Yeah, the fig is pretty subtle, but yeah, the sweet potato, it's, I don't know. Yeah, I would think it would lighten up the body a little bit, but it's plenty sweet, too, so it's not like...
Scottish.
Well, the fruit and everything in there, it's not drying everything out, so that's kind of nice that you were able to get the fruit in there without it, you know, that much fruit and vegetable matter in there without it going all the way dry. Yeah, yeah. The yeast helps, too.
Personally, for me, it's fruitier than a Scottish ale would be, so I don't think it could enter as straight as a Scottish ale. And
no.
Yeah,
I mean, sometimes it would be if you have a real subtle flavor. You're like, oh, I made a fruit beer, but it just didn't come through. You could still enter it as the base style.
Yeah.
You don't have to declare the fruit.
All right, Brian, what's next here, buddy?
So I was going to make a point about vital statistics and the guidelines go to great lengths to declare that it's not, you know, these numbers are not hard and fast numbers for what you're supposed to get, and when you get into mead and stuff, you're looking at the sweetness by the numbers, and a sweet mead should finish at this final gravity and start at this final gravity.
But really what you want to look at is what you get in your perceptions of it. And if you have judging friends, what they get is like the sweetness level of that mead or the beer or whatever it is, you know, just to make sure you're in the right place and declaring it properly. So, you know, just don't get hung up on the numbers and you know, use the vital statistics just kind of as a guideline, but don't be dominated by that.
That's a good point in general with beers. Yeah. Like numbers don't mean so much. And you probably even see, like, Jamil's book from so long ago. It's like,
yeah,
he always shot high.
Well,
you know, a little bit beyond the...
Yeah, it's like that beer we just had. I finished at 10.07, but it had the impression of some sweetness to it. So, you know, that's...
And don't always trust your equipment either.
Yeah. Could be off. So what's this other beer we got?
So this is a... Initially, it was brewed to be an imperial, Russian imperial stout. Sorry, that was double imperial.
double imperial.
It was brewed to be a Russian imperial stout aged in a whiskey barrel. I had a 15-gallon whiskey barrel that I bought from somewhere in Indiana, I think. I can't remember the actual distillery right now, sadly. But, Brian, you came over and tried it, and you were like, hey, this is just not roasty enough to be imperial stout. So I changed it up, and I entered the base version of it as a imperial sweet stout and managed, and I think it was the Maltose Falcons competition, took a second and best of show.
Cool.
With the beer. So I was like, oh, that's cool. But I had, you know, 15 gallons of it. So I'm like, what am I going to do with all this?
The rest of it, yeah.
Yeah. So I did all kind of different goofy stuff with it. Added coffee to one version of it. Added cacao nibs for another version of it. And then from that, the version that had cacao nibs, I actually then took two halves of that and added coconut to that.
Yeah, I liked the coffee one. I remember that. That was tasty.
So what this is, a blend of the coffee one.
I was going to say.
And a blend of the coconut one. Oops, sorry, I'm getting so mad I'm pounding the table.
Keep the smash.
It's the blend of the coconut cacao nibs one and the coffee one mixed together.
Okay, there's the coffee aromas there. And I'm like, well, what's going on? If this isn't the coffee one, then what was the coffee one like?
So it's the coconut one mixed together and cacao nibs together. So the point here is, like, how do you enter a beer as the imperial sweet stout with coconut, coffee, cacao nibs aged in a bourbon barrel? Where would you put that in terms of, and this is a test for you, Brian. Where do you put it?
Yeah, and chocolate is considered in with the spice or vegetable thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, and coffee. Yeah, I mean,
barrel age. Don't forget that.
And barrel age. So there's categories for all this stuff. You know, you don't have any fruit in it though. No fruit.
I could coconut if you. You know, I consider that a fruit or not. Some people don't, and I think they now say it is a nut more than a fruit. Although I did win in the Nationals with as a fruit beer. There's some people who were really angry about that. Like, coconut's not a fruit.
It's not a fruit.
What's wrong with you?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, whatever. So get over it, loser.
I would go for what's more intense in the flavor. So the cocoa... And the coconut are winning here, I think, and the barrel character. So that's, the barrel character definitely comes through. So I would enter it as so in the wood beer category, there's wood-aged beer and then there's specialty wood-aged beer. So wood-aged beer is for the kind of the classic base styles aged with wood. Yeah, and then there's especially wood-aged beers for wood-aged beers with other elements like booze barrel age, vanilla, coffee, etc. So I think that's the 33B is probably where this one would need to land.
I think this would be a fun part of the BJTB test they should add to it.
Like, how do you categorize
this beer? I give it to you. Like, here are the ingredients. Where would you categorize it?
That would be fun. Yeah, I get, I mean, in the flavors, I don't get a lot of the cocoa. And I think a lot of the dark malts are kind of covering that, but I get a lot of the coconut and the coffee. That's my personal take on it.
Yeah.
Like, I would probably leave out the nibs because I don't really get a lot of the nib character.
Right. And because, with this much... go ahead.
No, because, again, if you mention it, it has to be there.
Right.
So if it's not standing out, right, then you should just leave it, just omit it.
Right. I'm like, there's a reason to announce the cacao nibs are... Like, there's not a reason probably to do that. Just, like, leave it out and be like, it's just part of the beer.
And then,
God, it's a sweet beer, man. It's almost too sweet.
Carbonation's a little low right now. Got knocked then, around a little bit. But
maybe I do get the, like, on the there's like a that tart thing that cacao nibs can give. And it's like that sweet with the tart. It's almost sour, but it's not sour. It's almost tang. It's a tang.
A tangy acidic sharpness, yeah.
But that coconut's a really good flavor.
The coconut is good, and it's much more imbalanced than the last version of it that we tasted. Yeah.
That's why I modified it. That's what I do. I listen to Brian.
Good blending.
He gives me feedback. And I'm like,
what
hey,
did
I'm,
you
I'm
do? A, how did you modify it already into the
I
thing?
Just, I have like four different kegs of this, so I can move things around. And you know, so I have a coffee version. Mm-hmm. I have a regular version. I have a cacao nibs and coconut version, and I just have regular cacao nibs.
Okay.
The cacao nibs I was going to use today, but all my like brewing stuff was stacked on top of that, so I'm like, I'm not going to use that. I'll use the coffee version and blend the coffee version. And it's kind of funny you said, like, yeah, I can smell the coffee. So that was like, the coffee's been fading on that one. I feel like coffee does fade.
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I'm sorry, so you just added more of the coconut to the blend?
No, I just thought you did 50-50, so this has less coconut to the blend.
Because you said you modified it last week, so that's
the last week was all the straight coconut version
it
of
was
it.
Super coconut heavy.
Got it. Okay, yeah. That's what you did. Okay, got it. Okay.
Now, a lot of people would take this beer and just jump right into, you know, 34C experimental beer just because it has so many different things going on, but I think that can be a mistake. I would use 30, you know, jumping into specialty beer. Yeah, it's got to be something really special and really quirky and unique that kind of like puts the judges on their toes and like, whoa, this is, you know, fenugreek beer or something. With
fenugreek, but that's where you went.
I don't know, but with a, you know, something special.
Random, Brian. Fenugreek.
No, yeah, I mean, I don't know.
That would just be spice. That's a spice. That'd be spice.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of
cooking with your grandma.
I'm trying
day?
To think that's of quirky ingredients that are non
fenugreek. Is
pig no. skin, maybe pig skin would be a quirky ingredient.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bacon?
Or mushroom beer or something. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like,
that's a vegetable again.
No, it's a fungus. It's not a vegetable.
You tell me that's not going to count as a vegetable? So, did you categorize the last one? The sweet potato. What would you do with that?
Where did we land on that?
That's...
Let's categorize that beer and then this beer and then get final thoughts and then we got to get out of here. We're running a little over here, boys.
We're running low.
Sweet potato with fig. I would just enter it as a fruit beer, even though it's not going to win any awards that way.
Awesome.
Because the fig is what right. The fig is what comes through, but it's not. I want more fig.
It's not enough to. If you didn't know it was a fig. I don't think you would have picked out that it's a fig, but there's something.
You can't enter it as a straight beer. Right. If you enter it as a fig beer, it's probably not going to win. So this is one of those beers that I would say just don't enter it or blend it with something that has more fig flavor to get it to the right place.
Well, you know, that's another point. You don't have to enter everything that you brew.
Yeah, and that's kind of the nice thing I've found, like having, you know, again, a theme, but having a kid, it's like I don't have enough time to enter competitions to make all the beers that I need to make. So instead, I can just do these sort of outlier beers and not worry about them fitting in some competition.
Yeah.
It's like it's an enjoyable beer. I like this beer. I'm going to, you know, tomorrow night I'll enjoy it and be like, yeah, it's kind of subdued and there's nothing crazy about it. Like if you search, you could probably find those things if someone told you about it. But as a judge, you'd be like, no way, man, not going to win. Like Brian said, he's totally right. It would never win at all. Like, you know, like unless you enter a really crappy competition, like me, you know, like the Oktoberfest one.
Oh yeah, that one. Thanks.
I'm kidding.
Okay, so where would you put this Imperial Sweet Stout? The Imperial Sweet Imperial Stout.
I would go 33B, especially wood-aged beer with that.
Okay.
Because it's got the boost barrel, it's got a little vanilla, some coffee, it's got a lot of things going in. It's just definitely a specialty.
It's definitely a specialty.
And it's definitely a barrel-aged beer. You taste that barrel, you taste the wood,
okay.
You taste the booze a little bit. Yeah, yeah.
Cool.
But whereas if it were like a soured beer, you'd want to go to a wild specialty beer instead. You know, if it was like if it's a sour, there's certain things that just take precedence. If you have a sour beer, you have to kind of go into the Category 28 American Wild Ale to get
American
where you need to go. Okay. You know, then fruit beer has a lot of flexibility. You got fruit and spice, and especially for a catch-all, you know, spice beers has the spicer vegetable, autumn seasonals, and winter seasonals. So just kind of, okay, is it a pumpkin beer with spices, or is it a, you know, winter warmer with something going on? You know, just figure out where to put it based on the descriptions of those styles. There's some weird ones, too. Like, there's you know, category 31 is alternative grain beer. And, it's, you know, it's great for people that have celiac disease. They can use this sorghum and oats and this stuff doesn't have all that.
0.1% of the population.
That yeah. Bullshit. Sorry. Yeah.
No, there are really people that, yeah, that can't drink regular whatever. Grain beer. So, yeah. You know, the...
All right, let's,
we've had some of those.
Let's give us some final thoughts here, Brian, on this topic, please.
Yes.
Wrap it up.
Go by perceptions, not numbers. Just
yes.
And another good thing to do is to recheck bottles that have been stored for a while. Sometimes the perceptions of what's in there can change over time, especially
with
meads and stuff. You can have a mead that started out still and it went sparkling in the bottles. So
you want to be up to date on what's
make sure
in your
you know what's in there.
Make sure you have enough bottles left. I've lost mead competitions before because it was sparkling and I entered it as still and I was I only had two bottles left to enter in the competition and it was like. But at the same time, I've entered an old ale, like it was an old strong scotch, entered it as an old ale like 5 years later, and it won best of show. And it's like, oh, I tasted a bottle. I'm like, hey, this is an old ale, not a strong scotch anymore. That, you know, perfect.
Yeah.
So taste the beers if you have them and save bottles so you can actually taste them and get other people to taste them too with you. Get people who know about these things and enter competitions. And the point of it is if you want to win, then think about how a judge would think about your beer when tasting it and
serious about it.
Overall, just go for balance. If they see this style with these two ingredients, they're going to want to taste the base style and they're going to want to taste those two ingredients. You can declare one is lighter than the other if you have room in the comments or not, but declare what's there and don't declare what's not there. That's it.
Okay.
Really simple.
Very good.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I hope it helped you all to figure out how to categorize your beers. And I know that a few times we've had people, you know, give us beers and then ask us, well, where would you put it on the show? So
it's like, send us a German Pilsner and then, you know, like.
Enter it as a Mexican lager.
Yeah.
It's fine.
But sometimes the answer is to just rebrew it.
Just rebrew. You don't have to enter everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, everybody. Thanks a lot. Thank you to Terry. Of course, Terry's going to win our $40 At Least Your Beer Will Look Good Grog Tag gift certificate. And sorry about your bottles, bro. But, you know, we got one and that worked. And again, sorry for boning the whole, entry.
Well, Terry's a good sport.
Category.
I like
He was like, whatever. It's fine.
We had fun talking.
All right, everybody. Thanks a lot. And we'll catch you next time.
Thank you.
Bye.